All right. Vipul, are you there?
Yes, sir, I am here, sir.
Vipul, we'll start the presentation. I'm not sure whether Dr. Rajiv Chawla is able to join. And I
Okay,
have
sir.
today a network issue out here.
Okay.
So I would want you to just take the session forward. I'll be there in and out as my network is okay. So just take this forward. Okay.
No problem, sir.
So
I'm here.
we will have a first speaker today. Is Dr. Sachinanda Adiga, and he will be talking to us on association of asymptomatic bacteriuria, pyuria, and urinary heparin binding protein with obstetric outcome in gestational diabetes. You have 15 minutes to make your presentation, Dr. Sachinanda.
Okay, shall I start, sir?
Yes, please go ahead. Please
Am
go
I
ahead.
audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yeah, and
Yes, you
stick
are
to your
audible.
time so that we can complete all of them in required time.
Okay, sir. Good afternoon, sir. I'm Dr. Sachidananda Adiga, Professor of Pharmacology in KS at the Medical Academy. Today, I'm going to share my research work, which has been funded by RSSTI. The title goes like this: Association of Asymptomatic Bacteriuria, Pyuria, and Urinary Heparin Binding Protein in Gestational Diabetes Mellitus. So a little bit of background to this chapter. So gestational diabetes can be defined as glucose intolerance of varying severity with the onset or first recognition of this manifestation during the pregnancy. The overall prevalence of GDM is found to be around 9% in India. Asymptomatic bacteriuria, which constitutes around 2 to 5% of healthy adult women, whereas this asymptomatic bacteriuria can be seen as high as 3 to 4 times more common in women with diabetes mellitus in pregnancy, that is in GDM, than the healthy woman. Asymptomatic bacteriuria is considered clinically significant and worth treating during pregnancy because various literature have shown that it may lead to preterm delivery, and also it may be responsible for some of the manifestations like low birth weight and also some of the other complications associated with gestational diabetes. So by finding out asymptomatic bacteriuria, we can effectively reduce the risk of pyelonephritis and also preterm delivery, which can reduce the morbidity in case of pregnancy. So coming to the urine culture, what is the existing knowledge or what is the best current practice is urine culture is supposed to be the gold standard test to detect asymptomatic bacteria. But the problem is problem with this urine culture is it requires around 48 hours. So precious time is lost without being treated in a patient who is having a significant bacteriuria with the development of culture with the bacterial growth. So the need of the hour is search for an alternative urinary biomarker, among which heparin binding protein, which is a protein stored in the secretory and acidophilic granules of the human neutrophils. And various studies have come out with the various degrees of specificity as well as sensitivity compared to urinary WBC levels of this heparin binding. So in one study, that is Romero et al. Suggests that asymptomatic bacteriuria was strongly associated with the preterm delivery and low birth weight. In this context, it becomes very important to detect asymptomatic bacteriuria, and also if at all any new biomarkers are there, it could effectively reduce the preterm delivery as well as low molecular weight, low birth weight. Sorry. Okay, this formed the rationale for our study. And coming to the objectives of the studies, first objective is to find out the proportion of asymptomatic bacteriuria as well as pyuria in gestational diabetes mellitus patients, because there is in the literature it has been shown that there is the prevalence varies from geographical area to in various geographical area. Second one is to find out the association between the asymptomatic bacteriuria pyuria and urinary heparin binding protein in gestational diabetes. and to compare the sensitivity and the specificity of both the techniques, that is urine culture versus heparin, urinary heparin binding protein. And also we have got one more objective in which we are trying to look into the association between the pregnancy outcome in patients with asymptomatic bacteria. So these are the four objectives of our study. Coming to the methodology, the study setting was microbiology. It was done in microbiology, biochemistry wing of molecular lab of Department of Molecular Lab of Justice Case at the Medical Hospital, and also with the Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology of Notre Dame to be University. The study type was observational. Sample size was 100 cases of gestational diabetes and 100 cases of healthy pregnant woman. The project was supported by, funded by RSSPI, and it was approved. The project was approved by the Central Ethics Committee of Notre Dame to be University, and written informed consent was taken from all the patients as well as participants. The inclusion criteria for the study cases were gestational diabetes patients as per the DIPSI criteria, that is 75 grams of oral glucose, and the cutoff was taken more than 140 milligram per deciliter of random sugar. The control group, we have chosen normal healthy pregnant ladies in the second trimester of pregnancy. The exclusion criteria, we have excluded the participants of multiple pregnancy, known pre-gestational, known gestational diabetes, which has
sure,
previously, pregnancies complicated with malformities, malformations, and other major cardiac related and hepatic disorders, which are the the methodology. We have collected clean midstream urine from the patients, both patients as well as the control groups. Urine culture and sensitivity test was performed, and at the same time, urinary heparin binding protein was estimated by ELISA kit method. Coming to the statistical analysis, the data was analyzed by using the SPSS-23, the data were expressed as mean plus or minus standard deviation. Chi-square test was used to investigate to determine the association between asymptomatic bacteriuria pyorrhea with the heparin, urinary heparin binding protein, and to check for the sensitivity specificity, we have also then the receiver of ROC curve, which was constructed to compare the sensitivity as well as specificity of the test. Moving on to the results part, this table shows the patient demographic profile as well as urinary heparin binding protein characteristic. We have included, even though the sample size was 100, we could not enroll 100 gestational diabetes patients. We could enroll only 83 patients. Whereas control 100 healthy pregnant ladies we have included, the age which has been depicted here. The fasting blood sugar in the case was 184, whereas in the control group it was 95. And in 83 patients, we have come across asymptomatic bacteria in 4 patients in cases, and in healthy controls, 5 patients were detected of asymptomatic bacteriuria by the culture method. The percentage of asymptomatic bacteriuria, which accounts for 4.82% in cases as well as 5%. And from this study, from our findings, there was no difference in the occurrence of asymptomatic bacteriuria in cases as well as control groups. Again, this figure shows the urinary heparin binding proteins in asymptomatic bacteriuria positive patients as well as the negative patients. Just I will show the values in the table, which is more easily we can compare. In the group, the mean values of urinary heparin binding protein was 558.6, whereas in the normal pregnant ladies, that is control group, it was 479. Asymptomatic bacteriuria patients in GDM, it was slightly more, 602, whereas 535 in the compare group, whereas it was 536 in GDM patients without asymptomatic bacteria, whereas it was 464 in the control group. From this slide, what we can infer is that there was slight increase in the urinary heparin binding protein in asymptomatic bacteriuria patients with gestational diabetes, whereas there was no much, even though it was slightly high, it was not statistically significant. Moving on to our second objective, that was association between asymptomatic bacteriuria with the urinary heparin binding protein in gestational diabetes. As I told earlier, there were four patients with the asymptomatic bacteriuria in gestational diabetes mellitus. When we considered, when we constructed the ROC curve and took the reference point of 856 picogram per ml, we could find a significant association between the patients with the asymptomatic bacteriuria in having the higher higher urinary heparin binding protein, which was statistically significant, whereas in the control group it was not significant. This was the ROC curve which we have drawn for cases. So from this curve, what we can infer is that at the level of 856 picogram per ml, the specific sensitivity was 100% and specificity was 83%, whereas with the control group it was 83% sensitivity and the specificity was 77%, even though these sensitivity specificity values were seen at a higher value. So this figure shows the cases and control, the sensitivity as well as specificity values. The area under curve was significantly high for cases, 0.941, whereas the control group it was 0.682. Moving on to the pregnancy outcome, this was our last objective of the study. We could not get the data because it is ongoing. Still, we have compared here the data of 40 patients, because the pregnancy outcome will be only we will get after a few months. So in the GDM group, that is a case group, emergency LSES was performed in 9 patients, whereas elective were then performed in 8 patients. The values are given here. Okay, it can be noted that in the emergency LSES taken patients, the heparin binding protein was a little bit less. Whereas in the healthy control, none of them have gone for emergency LSES, whereas elective was performed in 6 patients. As far as infants born to mothers having asymptomatic bacteriuria, all the patients, all the kids were healthy. All the 10 kids born to the asymptomatic bacteriuria patient, both in the cases as well as mothers, were healthy. Two babies died in GDM group. However, none of the mother had asymptomatic bacteriuria. Only one infant had an Apgar score of 7 out of 10 in the GDM, whereas 8 by 10 by the end of 5 minutes. Rest all had an Apgar score of 9 out of 10. Coming to the discussion and conclusion, the proportion of GDM patients with the asymptomatic bacteria in our study was 4.8% when compared to the control group, it was 5%. Then we looked at various literature, it was found that the proportion ranged from 4% to 40%. Since our sample was very, very less, the lower percentage could be attributed to this. Whereas when we looked at the urinary heparin binding protein levels, the mean urinary heparin binding protein was 558 picogram in GDM patients, whereas patients with asymptomatic bacteriuria in GDM, it was 608. Both the values, when we compare with the previous literature, it was much less. In the previous literature, previous various studies, it has been quoted that the urinary heparin binding levels were 3 to 5 nanogram. However, in our study, it was very less. Moving on to the association, we will go with the study, the results of various other studies, which has quoted that there was statistically significant association between urinary heparin binding protein and the asymptomatic bacteriuria patients. The chi-square value was very high. So our study supports the previous studies. Okay, and also the sensitivity of urinary heparin binding protein estimation in asymptomatic bacteriuria patients was 100% at value of 856 in diabetics, whereas the specificity was 88%. And from our study, even though the sample size was less, we could analyze the results of pregnancy outcome of only 40 patients. There was not much difference when compared to the previous literature. Only 9%, 11% of the individual went for emergency LSES. Whereas in healthy patients, we would like to conclude once again that in the study sample which we have chosen, that was 183, we could find roughly around 5% of patients going for asymptomatic bacteriuria, which is it is in the range of the previous literature, which has quoted from 5 to 40%. That is one finding. The second finding is there is a statistically significant association between the urinary heparin binding protein as well as asymptomatic bacteriuria patients at various sensitivity level. And from our study, we have to get the clinical outcome data of around more than 50% of the individuals. But as of now, we can conclude that asymptomatic bacteriuria patients did not have this status has no relation to the outcome of the obstetric outcome in terms of preterm delivery or APGAR score or infant mortality or emergency procedures like LSES, etc. Thanking you. We would like to acknowledge the support which is given by RSSTI New Delhi for providing a generous research grant for this project. And our sincere thanks goes to our study participants for their participation, and our sincere gratitude to our dean, hospital superintendent, as well as university officials for their logistic support. Thank you. Thank you very much. These are my references.
Dr. Adiga, may I ask what was the mean glucose value of the patients with gestational diabetes mellitus?
100 and one second, it was 184.
184.
It was by DIPSI. DIPSI.
Right. Right. And did you test their urine glucose?
No, ma'am. No.
You didn't. Okay. All right. Shall we invite the next participant then? Dr. Yes. Agrawal, do you have to say anything?
Madam, sir has a network issue right now.
All right.
Let's invite the second speaker. If Dr. Swati Ahir Beast is here. And Dr. Usha Adiga.
She's here. She will join.
Are you going to present on behalf of her?
No. She will be presenting. One second.
Okay. So please unshare your slide so that she can share and discuss. Dr. Usha Adiga will
sir,
present.
Just 2 minutes, sir. I need to
about
the slide. Yeah.
Yes, you can, sir, and you can
yes,
continue.
Sir, 1 minute.
Vipul is. Can we take the next speaker in?
Yes, sir. Dr. Usha is presenting her poster.
Okay, so is Dr. Swati not going to present right now?
She's not here, sir.
All right, so Dr. Usha is going to log in and present her presentation now. Is she there?
From this only, sir.
From Sachidanand's slide, she is going to present,
sir. So we invite Dr. Usha Adiga, and she'll be speaking to us on association of a single nucleotide polymorphism of leptin gene with metabolic parameters in gestational diabetes. Association of leptin gene polymorphism with metabolic parameters, which is supposed to be a cross-sectional study. So over to you, Dr. Usha.
Just 1 second. Hello.
Yes, your slides are visible. You can continue.
Sir, good afternoon. I'm Dr. Usha Adiga, Professor of Biochemistry in KSF, the Medical Academy. First of all, I would like to thank RSSBI for awarding the grants for us on the topic Association of Leptin Gene Polymorphism with Metabolic Parameters in Gestational Diabetes. Part of it, a little deviation of this topic, we have studied it in leptin receptor gene polymorphism also, with the permission from RSSBI, and that paper has been accepted in a Q1 journal with impact factor 4. We have not included that result because already it's accepted for publication. So this is going to be our report presentation, and presentation will be done by my senior research fellow and my PhD student, Ms. Desi TM. Thanks again for awarding us the grant, sir. Over to Ms. Desi. Hello, sir. Hello. So, my sir, Desi. So the study.
Yeah, you can continue.
Okay.
Yeah, please continue.
Okay. The study was funded by RSSTA, and it was titled as Association of Leptin Gene Polymorphism with Metabolic Parameters in Gestational Diabetes Mellitus. So they create a cross-sectional study. Coming to the introduction. So during pregnancy, the plasma produces hormones such as estrogen, cortisol, and human placental lactogen, which has a blocking effect on the insulin. So thereby it inhibits the functioning of insulin. So it results in high blood glucose levels, and it causes gestational diabetes mellitus. And this condition has a prevalence of 7% worldwide and about 9% in India. And the leptin, which is an important adipokine hormone, and it is involved in pathways influencing the risk of diabetes, and it has the ability to improve insulin resistance or induce insulin resistance. So some studies have reported the leptin levels are to be altered. It may be increased or decreased in gestational diabetes mellitus, and also they have found an association with the insulin resistance. Some studies have reported the elevation of leptin levels are due to upregulation of leptin gene due to insulin resistance and hyperinsulinemia. Hofstadter et al. Reported the leptin G polymorphism, that is G2548A polymorphism, which is found to be associated with the hyperleptinemia. And Young et al. Studied both this leptin gene and its receptor polymorphism in the Chinese population, but there are no such reports available in the Indian population. So the aim of the study was to find the association of leptin gene polymorphism with metabolic parameters in gestational diabetes mellitus. Objectives of the study: first one was to evaluate the pattern of leptin gene polymorphism in GDM and to find its association with the levels of leptin. Second one was to compare the leptin with the biochemical parameters in GDM patients and normal pregnant women. Third one was to find the association between the leptin gene polymorphism with the biochemical parameters and the insulin resistance and lipid profile in the gestational diabetes mellitus. Last one was to find the association between leptin gene polymorphism and child birth weight. Coming to the materials and methods, the study was a cross-sectional study which was carried out in the Endocrinology and Molecular Genetics Wing of Central Research Laboratory of KSHD Medical Academy in collaboration with the Department of OBG, KSHD Charitable Hospital, Nite University. And the study subjects included 100 GDM patients diagnosed as per the ADA 2018 criteria as cases, and the controls were 100 gestational age and BMI matched normal glucose tolerant pregnant woman, and the cases of multiple pregnancies, non-pre-gestational diabetes, and the pregnancies complicated by the major fetal malformations like cardiac, renal, or hepatic disorders, and pregnancy-induced hypertension cases were excluded from the study. And the study was carried out during April 2018 to March 2020. And for the investigation part, 5 ml of venous blood was collected from the patients after obtaining their informed consent. From that, 2 ml of EDTA blood was used for the DNA extraction and genotyping using the PCR-RFLP method. And the plain blood was used for the analysis of fasting leptin, insulin, and C-peptide using the ELISA technique. And the lipid profile was analyzed using the auto-analyzer method. And the 1 ml of fluoride whole blood was used for the analysis of fasting blood sugar using the auto-analyzer. And various insulin resistance models were analyzed using the standard formula. And the PCR was carried out using the suitable forward and reverse primer. And after that, it was digested using the suitable restriction enzyme HHA1, and which was visualized on the 2% agarose gel with ethereum bromide staining. And the statistical analysis was carried out using SPSS version 23, and the categorical data were expressed as percentages and continuous data were expressed as mean plus or minus standard deviation. The Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium was used for finding the association between leptin gene variant among cases, and the chi-square test was used to compare the distribution of allele frequencies between different variants and for finding the association between genotypes, distribution, and biochemical parameters, and also for finding the association between the leptin gene polymorphism and child birth weight. The Mann-Whitney U-test was used for the comparing the biochemical parameters between the cases and countries. And the Spearman correlation test was used for the correlation study. And the odds ratio was used for finding the extent of risk of leptin gene polymorphism in causing GBM and for reducing birth weight. Coming to the results, we have compared the biochemical parameters and insulin resistance in GDM and normal pregnant women. However, we couldn't find any significant difference between the parameters, biochemical parameters and lipid profile. However, we found a significant increase in fasting blood sugar level and C-peptide level and C-peptide-based HOMA insulin resistance. And we found significant lower level of HOMA B cell and HOMA 1% B cell and the C-peptide-based insulin resistance. This is the sample pattern of distribution of alleles of leptin gene. Here, the AA gene is with a single band is the wild type, homozygous dominant, and GG is homozygous recessive model, and the GA is the mutant type, heterozygous recessive. And we have found the association between the GDM and leptin gene polymorphism using the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, where chi-square value, chi-square statistics with AIDS correction value of 0.1694 and the p-value of 0.68, suggesting that alleles were in equilibrium. And we also found the patients who had ALE frequency had is having a 1.25 times higher risk of developing GDM. We also compared the biochemical parameters in GDM patients with the different genotypes of leptin gene, but we couldn't find any significant difference. And also we have compared with the various insulin resistance models. There also we couldn't find any significant difference. And no association were found between the birth weight of babies and genotypes and insignificant difference in birth weights of the babies in different alleles were found. And however, the patients with AA genotypes were 1.5 times at higher risk of getting low birth weight babies. Coming to the discussion, the present study did not show any association between the leptin gene polymorphism in gestational diabetes mellitus. Our study has found that the frequency of A alleles were higher than the G alleles for the leptin gene polymorphism, which was supported by a study by Wang et al. They also showed A allele predominance in a Taiwanese population. But there are some studies which have shown that G allele frequency was higher than the A allele frequency. And from our study, there was no significant association between the leptin gene polymorphism and leptin levels. But there are studies, studies have reported that the leptin gene polymorphism had a strong influence on the leptin gene expression. And there were some inconsistent role of leptin levels also. And we found there is no significant difference in the leptin levels between the GDM patients and the subjects with the normal glucose tolerance. And it was compared with the different genotypes. And we found that it is also insignificant. But patients with the AA allele had highest serum leptin levels. And this was supported by various studies. And there were some insignificant differences also. And the leptin gene polymorphism was associated with the increased leptin production and plasma secretion from the adipocytes. And but some studies by Endo et al. Reported that this plasma leptin levels and placental leptin expression in women with GDM were significantly increased in comparison with the healthy pregnant women. When we compared the insulin resistance models among the cases and controls, we got significantly low levels of insulin HOMA B cell, HOMA 1% B cells in cases, and as well as the C-peptide based in HOMA B cell C and HOMA 1% B cells were significantly high. And this was supported by some studies and there were some contradictory reports also available. And we could there was no significant difference between the lipid profile parameters in cases and controls. And This also was supported by various studies. Coming to the conclusion, there was no significant association between the leptin gene polymorphism and biochemical parameters in GBM. However, the homozygous AA alleles were 1.5 times at higher risk of developing GBM. So the association of gene polymorphism and birth weight of the babies was insignificant. Those with AA alleles were showing 1.5 times the higher risk of getting low birth weight babies. The leptin gene polymorphism may have a role in the pathogenesis and outcome of pregnancy complicated with GBM. And also we found the leptin and insulin act antagonistically and influence lipid levels in GBM. The study could establish a cycle of gene polymorphism altering leptin levels, which in turn can alter insulin secretion and insulin resistance, contributing for the dyslipidemias of pregnancy as well as gestational diabetes. These are our references. Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
Yeah. Was there any association with weight or weight gain?
No, ma'am. Weight gain, there was no association statistics-wise. Really was not significant, but we found that the birth weight of the babies were 1.5 times lower birth weight in patients with AAR.
No, I'm asking about mother's weight.
Mother's weight. No, there was no association.
Okay. Have you seen it?
Actually, we have taken BMI that was pre-pregnancy and during their checkup, I mean ANC checkup.
Right. So that will give you weight gain during pregnancy. So that will be an interesting thing to see if you can.
10 to 11 kg weight gain is there, but association statistics we have not seen.
Okay. If you have the data, it would be a good thing to go back and look at it.
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
Okay. Nice presentation.
Thank you, ma'am.
Andi ma'am, Dr. Swati is here now. Can we take her?
So, yes, please.
Dr. Swati, are you there?
Hello. Yes, am I audible?
Okay, you are audible and now you are going to present your oral presentation.
Yes.
Dr. Swati Ahir Bist will present assessment of Coxsackie virus infection, lipase and amylase in pediatric type 1 diabetes. Over to you, Dr. Swati.
Sir, I have started sharing my screen. Please let me know if you can see it.
Yeah, I can see it and it is in on presentation mode.
Okay, I'll just start. Good evening, everyone. So my topic of my study is assessment of Coxsackie virus infection, cytokine profiles, lipase and amylase in pediatric type 1 diabetes. This is a part of my postdoctoral work that I was doing as an ICMR postdoctoral fellow. Just a sec. I'll just put this on a slideshow mode. Shall I stop my camera because this again goes into... just a sec. Yeah. Okay. So as we know that diabetes is now one of the leading causes of death among the world population, with it being at number 6 position in causing deaths worldwide. This is according to the WHO report of 2019. In India itself, 1 in 11 adults now have diabetes, which is either known or, due to unknown causes. There are a lot of people who don't get themselves tested and do not know that they are actually diabetic. And many of the, even with children, the incidence has been rising year on end. In India, the number of children with type 1 diabetes is somewhere around 1,84,000. And this number is just an estimate. It could be much more than that, with newly diagnosed cases around 21,000 each year. As we know that type 1 diabetes is mainly caused due to destruction of the beta cells which produce the insulin. And prolonged diabetes has been shown to lead to many complications such as neuropathy, retinopathy, nephropathy, etc. And it also is a major cause of heart attacks, stroke, and lower limb amputation in the diabetic patients. The mechanism of type 1 diabetes is already known, with some cytokines such as interferon gamma and TNF-alpha being as known as the causative agents that are responsible for causing the beta cell destruction. And apart from this, other factors such as nitrous oxide production, variation in the levels of enzymes such as superoxide dismutase, which is known as SOD3, has also been known as cofactors which lead to the cell destruction. Recently, CVB infection, that is Coxsackie virus B infection, has been associated with type 1 diabetes world across. This is because the beta cells have been found, the pancreatic cells have been found to have CAR receptors, which are Coxsackie and adenovirus receptors, which are specific to the Coxsackie virus and the adenovirus. So probably these infections are triggering the type 1 diabetes. And this has already been established in mouse studies, but the proper clear association in human studies is not there as such. So EVRNA has also been detected in pancreatic tissues of cadavers who were basically type 1 diabetic patients, but a clear association is yet not available. So the lacunae is association of enteroviruses, specifically the CVB, has never been reported in our population. The role of cytokines, especially the cytokine production by T cells, has not been studied. And type 1 diabetic genetics needs further evaluation in our population, because most of the research has been more in the non-Hispanic white population. Hence, type 1 diabetes needs more study. This brings me to the aim of my study, which is estimation of CVB infection and T-cell cytokines in the pathogenesis of pediatric type 1 diabetes. The objectives were to identify the CVB infection in the groups, to analyze the intercellular cytokine profiles of the TH cells, to estimate serum cytokine levels, and to quantify serum amylase and lipase levels for possible association. The experimental groups were type 1 diabetic children. We had estimated to enroll around 100 diabetic children and 50 healthy controls, taking into consideration confounding factors such as age, sex, BMI, the insulin intake, any history, and family history of diabetes. The experimental protocol was, at the time of enrollment, we collected 5 ml of EDTA and we used a portion of that for RNA extraction to see the CVB infections, and PBMCs were used for intracellular cytokines by flow cytometry. The serum was used for lipase and amylase, for antibodies and other blood tests in our groups. First is to objective is to evaluate the CVB infection. So we did an RT-PCR to see for the current infection in all the recruited participants. Apart from that, we did IgG and IgM ELISA in serum samples to see a past CVB infection in the population. Then the flow cytometry part, here we use the PBMCs. And we stimulated them either with a non-specific stimulant, which acts as a positive control, using peptides, which are specific for the CVB infection, and non-stimulating. This acted as a negative control for our flow cytometric studies to see the cytokine production in the CD3, CD4, and CD8 cells. Then we used a human procartoplex panel to study the serum cytokine levels. We estimated 11 cytokines in all the diabetic and the healthy controls. We also did serum amylase and lipase levels using an automated clinical chemistry analyzer. Coming to the results, these are the details of enrollment. We could counsel 88 participants of which 70 could be enrolled into our study. 18 were such who either did not fit the eligibility criteria or were denied participation. All this enrollment was carried out before the start of the lockdown. And after the lockdown, we could not enroll more children, mainly because of the ethical issues. And secondly, because we were not getting more patients in the OPD department. Healthy children were completed. We could enroll 54 healthy children, of which 47 were proper healthy controls, and 7 were such who were pre-diabetic, where their HbA1c was greater than 6 in these children. These are the demographics of the healthy controls and the type 1 diabetic. Most, in both the groups, we had taken age-matched and sex-matched controls. As compared to the type 1 diabetics, there was only difference was seen in the BMI of the children, which was significantly higher in the type 1 diabetic children. Also, as expected, the random blood sugar and the HbA1c levels were higher and significant in the diabetic children. Coming to the CBV infection, at the time of enrollment, a current CVV infection was not found in any of the enrolled subjects, be it diabetic or be it healthy controls. Past infections in the form of IgG and IgM were estimated, with the prevalence being almost similar in both the groups, and there was not any the p values were also insignificant. So probably the CVV infection, which is a very common infection in the Indian population, might not have that kind of a role to play with respect to the infection prevalence in our population. Coming to objective 2, the flow cytometric analysis, this is the normal gating strategy that I have used, where first we selected out the lymphocyte population, followed by the CD3 positive cells. And from the CD3 positive cells, we could isolate the CD4 cells, we could get the CD8 cells and individual cytokine product producing cells. This is just an example of how I have used the gating strategy in all the population for different cytokines as well. This is the comparison example between the samples. Since we have used a negative control, which is the INHIP, a positive control, which is the stimulant, and the two peptides against the CVV infection and the cytokine production. This is a clearer picture to see how the cytokine population has been gated. You can see that peptide 2 produces a lot of interferon gamma as compared to the negative controls and the other peptide and non-specific stimulant. So interferon gamma producing cells, CD4 were the major interferon gamma producing cells in the population, and which were higher in the diabetic children as compared to the healthy controls. CD8 interferon gamma producing cells were almost similar in the healthy controls as well as the diabetic patients. Interleukin 2 was not shown to be significant in any of the groups, and also the CD4 and the CD8 cells. Interleukin 4 was also increased in the diabetic children as compared to the healthy controls, only in the CD4 producing CD4 interleukin 4 producing cells. And TNFA was higher in both the CD4 and CD8 producing cells in the diabetic children as compared to the healthy controls. Then we went on to estimate the serum cytokine levels. As I had mentioned, we had estimated 11 cytokines in all the healthy controls and the diabetics. Here I have presented the averages of the groups, which were estimated as picograms per mole in the serum samples. And among all the cytokines, interleukin 18 was the only one which was shown to be highly significant in our population, and the levels was twice as much in diabetic children as compared to the healthy controls. Then coming to the fourth objective, that was the estimation of the serum amylase and lipase levels. The amylase and lipase levels was almost similar in both the groups, and there was no significance achieved. To summarize my results, cytokine production in healthy subjects in response to CVV peptides is less as compared to the diabetic children. Increased frequencies of TNF-alpha and interferon-gamma producing cells in presence of peptide stimulation was seen. IgG and IgM antibodies against CVV were similar in both the groups, and lipase and amylase levels were also similar in both the groups. So this leaves us to the question that probably it is the cytokine response that is produced in presence of the CVV infection that might be acting as a factor to lead to type 1 diabetes in these children. Now, this could be because of an immunological cross-reactivity or an exposure to an autoantigen that might be leading to increased inflammation as a means of autoimmune response in type 1 diabetes. CVB may be alternating cytokine production in the CD4 and CD8 T cell subsets in the diabetic patients. And as we know that pro-inflammatory cytokine response is the major risk factor in type 1 diabetic pathogenesis, which was also confirmed by our study. So here is just a model that I have hypothesized that a progressive beta cell damage in the type 1 diabetic children because of persistence of TNF-alpha, interleukin-18 and interferon-gamma might be leading to an autoimmune response, thereby causing the type 1 diabetes in these children. Hence, to conclude, immune cells are involved in differential expression of cytokines. Pro-inflammatory cytokines promote destructive insulitis as potent mediators of beta cell toxicity. And CVV infections are though prevalent in equal amounts in both the groups. I would like to thank my HOD, Dr. Jayanti Mania Pramanik, our collaborators, Dr. Sudha Rao from BJ Wadia Hospital in Parel, Dr. Suchitra Surve from ICMR NIRRH, from where we could collect our healthy controls and the type 1 diabetic children, and funding that I have received from ICMR PDF Fellowship and RSSDI. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swati. I think that was an excellent research paper that you just presented and very informative.
May I ask a question?
Yeah, Anjali, go ahead. And can you introduce the next speaker and also, please?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Dr. Swati, did you present data regarding either GAD antibodies or IA2 antibodies in these patients?
No, ma'am. Actually, we are in the process of gathering the data because GAD antibodies is usually tested in the type 1 diabetic patients. So we have the data. Only thing is we are not able to gather the data because of, not being able to go to COPD. Yeah.
That is a must-have data, Dr. Swati, because of which only you will be able to see the patients are type 1 and it is an autoantibody reaction.
Yes,
unless
ma'am.
We have antibodies against either GAD, IA2 or zinc transporter or something that suggests autoimmunity behind the pathophysiology of diabetes. So that's a must-have data. Without
yes,
that,
ma'am.
We can't come to any conclusion.
No, ma'am, that was a part of our inclusion criteria. Sorry, I have not put that slide of inclusion and exclusion. But yes,
right.
Antibody testing is a part of our inclusion criteria for type 1 diabetes.
All right. All right. All right.
Okay.
Ma'am. Okay. Inviting the next speaker, the next presentation by
yes,
Dr. Ahmed Ali. Will you announce it?
Yes, ma'am, I will do it.
Yeah.
Next speaker is Ahmed Ali, and he will present study of glycation of proteins by sweeteners. Over to you, doctor.
Yeah, very good afternoon to all the participants and chair of the sessions. So, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
So I guess I hope my slides are visible.
Slides are visible. You can continue.
Thank you. On onset, let me thank the RSSDI for giving me this opportunity to work on this project for as a collaborative project. Since last 2 years, we have been working on this project, and as the title is that it's a preliminary kind of a study where we have characterized the involvement of sweeteners, basically artificial sweeteners, in the process of glycation. So I'll just have a few slides of introduction, then I'll come to my results and conclusion. So I'll have this, this will be my developed contents. So the primary aim of the project was to characterize the process and products of the glycation between sugar, sweeteners, and proteins. Secondary aim was to study on the structural alteration of glycated proteins and prevention of these structural alterations by vitamins and antioxidants. So there are two parts. One is the major aim was to see the involvement of sweeteners. So just a recent slide from the IDF, which suggests that 537 million people are suffering from diabetes or living with diabetes, which is projected to increase to 643 million. And the concern is that almost one in two or half of the population is not diagnosed with the diabetes. And the second major concern is that 4 out of 5 people are living in low and middle income countries. So with these concerns, I'll not go into detail of diabetes because I'm in the August gathering of best diabetologists of India. So we all know the biochemical mechanism is that there is an increase in the glucose level during the diabetes, which leads to accumulation of undesired products because of the glucose toxicity and its reactivity. So the modern theory of diabetes suggests that the two implications are oxidative stress and glycation. And these two processes cause severe secondary complications related to diabetes. So when there is an accumulation of glucose in the body, or what we call as hyperglycemia, these glucose molecules are able to modify the proteins in different ways, like protein carbonylation, protein acetylation, protein somalylation, and one of them is protein glycation, which is a direct manifestation of the reductive nature of glucose. So in simple terms, the glycation can be defined as a spontaneous, non-enzymatic aminocarbonyl reaction between the sugars and the long-lived proteins, lipids, and nucleates. So this results in the formation of CYP bases, Amadori products, and later on, further modification leads to the production of advanced glycation products, or in short, AGs. So this process happens continuously in the body, but the body has a mechanism to control the production and removal of these undesired products. However, if there is a sustained hyperglycemia, there is an accumulation of these glycation products in the form of CYP bases, Amadori products, and advanced glycation products, which have been implicated in many metabolic disorders and cardiovascular disorders. So this figure shows what are the different stages of this glycation. So in earlier stages, there are the formation of CYP bases and Amadori products, which can be reversed. But once the Amadori products are formed and moved to the dicarbonyl compounds, there is no reversal. And this process, although it's slow, leads to generation of these AGs, which are very harmful and deleterious to the biomolecules and the cellular structure. So all of us are aware of this term, that is HbA1c, glycated hemoglobin, which is because of the production of, or which is because of the enhanced rate of glycation in the body, and has been used as a tool to monitor diabetic history of diabetic, because it gives an history of almost 2 to 3 months, unlike fasting blood or glycated albumin in the body. So this was one concern, that there is an increased incidence and the biochemical mechanism is glycation. And on the other hand, as a part of awareness and diabetic management and preference for low calorie diets, there has been an increased uptake of or consumption of artificial sweeteners, which are generally non-nutritive and low calorie. So far, 6 artificial sweeteners have been approved by the FDA, which include aspartame, saccharin, sucralose, neotame, acelfame, potassium, and advantame. So these we see this all these brands in the market like Trivia or Equal or Sweet and Low. A few characteristics of this artificial sweeteners: they are about 30 to 30,000 times as sweet as natural sugar, that is sucrose. They provide same amount of sweetness, which less amount of consumption. So that leads to less restricted calorie intake. So preferred by consumers to cut the energy or sugar intakes for health reasons in this case of diabetics. So they are generally recognized as GRAS. However, the major consumption has been that there has been an increase in the several fold of this artificial consumption. We don't have the data all over the world, but in America, there has been a bigger study because there has been lots of opposition about this consumption of artificial sweeteners. So with this, I'm moving to my research work. So we used spectroscopic and spectrofluorimetric techniques along with the electron microscopic techniques, which we'll see during the course of the study, to evaluate the involvement of process. So we started with the aim that there is an increased consumption, whether these artificial sweeteners also cause glycation or not. So it was a kind of blind study. We didn't know that whether this causes glycation or lead to inhibition of glycation. So earlier, the hypothesis was that, they may be involved in the glycation. So we started with the five of the sweeteners, except advantame. We worked on all these five, and we showed that that unexpected to our assumption, and the acelfame potassium caused a several decrease in the formation of early and advanced glycation products. We measured the browning also, because browning is known as Maillard reaction. So you can see that among all these five sweeteners, acelfame was the most potent in inhibiting the glycation. Means they were not, none of these sweeteners, artificial sweeteners, caused or were involved in increasing the amount of glycation products. You can see that this is the red, that is 100% of the browning that is in the presence of, that is because of the interaction between the BSA and glucose. So there was no increase in the early and advanced glycation products by any of these sweeteners. However, in contrast, there was a significant decrease by almost 32.75 or 33% and 50% in the amount of early and advanced glycation products by acelfame. Then we measured the amount of aggregation, because it has been shown that glycation causes aggregation of the proteins. So we used two methods, Congo Red and aggregation index. Here also we showed that acelfame was the most potent among the sweeteners for causing the aggregation, inhibition of the aggregate glycation induced aggregation. So with this, we further studied all glycation studies with the acelfame potassium, because we realized that there is no effect, or these sweeteners do not cause an increase in the glycation. On the other hand, acelfame was acting as a significant anti-glycating molecule. We also used another sugar derivative, that is methyl glyoxal. It has been reported to be involved in many of the diabetic complications, and it has been found to be more reactive than glucose, almost 200 times more reactive. It is produced in the body. So here also we showed that it is significantly inhibiting the amount of MG-induced glycation with the BSA. So then we measured the total amount of fluorescent ages. I have used the term fluorescent ages because ages are can be fluorescent and non-fluorescent also. So it gives an idea about the amount of advanced glycation products generated in the system. So we measure total fluorescence, total ages by using fluorimetric instruments. So here also, you can see that this red line, scattered line, shows that the amount of total ages produced in BSA and glucose system. And when we use this acylfame potassium, there was a significant reduction in the amount of total ages by almost 33%. Glycation is also known to induce a structural alteration, and this structural alteration can be at the level of secondary and tertiary. We measured the secondary structure alteration by using circular dichroism spectroscopy. So here you can see that this red line shows the deviation from the structure of the BSA, native BSA. You can see this blue line shows the native BSA, and this red line shows the shift in the structure of BSA in the presence of glucose. But when we added acylfame potassium in the glycation system, that was BSA plus glucose, we could show that the native structure of the BSA was maintained. So we could interpret from here that the BSA acylfame potassium is also able to prevent the secondary structure alteration of BSA, which is because of the glycation process. So we used a very significant tool to study the aggregation of the proteins, that is known as thioflavin T assay. Here we could show that the presence of glucose causes the aggregation of the BSA. This is indicated by the red line. And then the presence of BSA plus acylfame in the glycation system severely reduced the aggregation of the BSA. So this we measured we use dynamic like scattering to measure the size of the particles which are generated. And here we could show that there is a significant reduction in the size of particles, that is because of the aggregation of the proteins. So this also confirms, and the most important confirmation about the suppression of glycation-induced aggregation came from this transmission electron microscopy. You can see in the diagram, figure B, that there is a heavy aggregation of the BSA in the presence of glucose, which is reversed in the presence of acylfame potassium, that we can see in the figure D. We didn't stop here. We used the polyacrylamide gel electrophoresis tool also to study this. You can see that lane B shows aggregation of the BSA, and lane 4 shows the migration of the protein and pattern of the protein, which is quite similar to the lane 1, that is the native protein. It has been also known that glycation leads to generation of free radicals or ROS, and that may induce the damage to the biomolecules. And one of the very good marker is DNA. Here we used PBR322 as a model DNA to study. You can see here in the lane 2, there is a conformational change from supercoiled to circular and linear form. And when we added, that is an indicative of the damage to the DNA, because the supercoil gets a nick because of the free radicals and glycation adducts. So that converts gets converted to circular and linear form. So in the presence of acylfame in the lane 4, we can see that there is a reversal of the DNA damage. So we can see that acylfame potassium was able to prevent the glycation induced or glycoxidative damage of the DNA. Then we characterized whether there is an interaction between the BSA and the protein glycation and the acylfame or not. So we did the quenching study, that is a fluorimetric study. We could show here that with increasing the concentration of acylfame potassium, from 5 micromolar to 100 micromolar, we could show that there is an increased quenching of the protein. So that means there is an interaction between the protein and the acylfame potassium. Then we did a docking study. So this was also, this can be also a preliminary study, or this can be also a confirmatory study, because so far we have been showing that there is anti-glycating potential of acylfame potassium. So we suspected that there may be a binding overlap between the BSA and glucose and BSA and acylfame. So we could show here that beta-2-glucose binds to BSA with an affinity of -5.9 kilocalorie per mole on this serine histidine proline. So acylfame also showed a similar kind of binding pattern with a similar kind of binding affinity. So it means that there is some kind of binding overlap between the BSA used in the studies. Is thymoquinone, which is obtained from black cumin. It had been shown to have many of this health benefits. So we could measure the early and advanced glycation products by using NBT assay and diphenyl hydrazine. We could show that a very low concentration of thymoquinone, that is 20 micromolar, is able to significantly suppress the amount of glycation products. Then we measure the aggregation and total edges. Here also we could show that thymoquinone was very efficient in inhibiting the formation of total edges and the glycation induced aggregation. We use this vitamin to analyze, and we could show that partially it has been it has the potential to suppress the browning and early and advanced glycation products. So with all these results, we came to conclusion that one of these artificial sweeteners, that is acylfame potassium, has the capability to reduce the, or has the capability to suppress the early formation of early and advanced glycation products, total edges, and suppress the protein aggregation, as well as it is able to reverse the secondary structure alteration of DNA and glycoxidative damage of DNA. We could also show that there is a fluorescent quenching of BSA with ASK that shows an interaction between them. Thymoquinone and thymine were also potent anti-glycating agent. So however, there are many untold stories in this. We are planning to move ahead with this study and identify the glycation sites on the protein and hemoglobin and collagen, other proteins which are severely affected by glycation. Then we are also planning to do some animal studies and antibody studies, where we can find the interaction between the age which are suppressed and which are produced during the glycation in the presence of acylfame potassium and natural products. We'll be also doing some studies to understand the mechanism of aggregation. We have done partial studies on fluorometric quenching, but we'll be doing more of these studies, and using the thermodynamic studies we'll be identifying the or we'll be evaluating the binding studies between the protein and acylfame potassium. And so far the study has been in the lab, that is in vitro. We will be confirming these studies using the cell lines animal models and collaborating with clinicians for clinical studies. So I acknowledge the contribution of my PhD students, Dinesh, Aditya, and Prerna. And again, I'm thankful to RSSDI for providing funding for this. We have received funding from UGC and we are a DST Fish department. My collaborators are Dr. Deepthi Singh from NIRH and Dr. S. Shivakami from Department of Biophysics, University of Mumbai. And these are some publications which have come out of this work. So anti-glycating potential of acesulfame potassium, differential glycation of arginine and lysine by people, and inhibition by acesulfame potassium. Then recently I have published a review article on artificial sweeteners and their health implication. And we have worked on the plant seed extracts as well as bioactive compounds. Thank you for listening to the presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. I think that was an excellent paper, and we really enjoyed listening to it. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Us is the first group to do a study on artificial sweeteners on and its role in glycation.
Yes, I could see that it's very original research that you've done, and I'm sure it's going to be a path breaking for future. And we look forward for more publications from you. Thank you so much. May I invite our next speaker, Dr. Sanjay Khatri? Is he there?
So shall I stop sharing?
Yeah, stop sharing, please. Is Dr. Sanjay Khatri there?
So let's start with the presentation. The normal population can be divided into normal, pre-diabetes or diabetes. Normal, when the FPG, that is fasting plasma glucose, is less than 100, or postprandial blood glucose is less than 140. Pre-diabetes, it can be impaired fasting glucose, also known as IFG, when fasting plasma glucose is 101 to 125, or IGT, that is impaired glucose tolerance, when postprandial blood glucose is 141 to 199, or both. And diabetes is classified when fasting plasma glucose is more than equal to 126 and postprandial blood glucose is more than equal to 200 milligram per deciliter. Coming to the endocrine axis and their relation with diabetes, let's start with the hypothalamus pituitary and thyroid axis. Diabetes has been seen associated with hypothyroidism and subclinical hypothyroidism. This decreased level of thyroid hormone leads to impaired glucose absorption from gastrointestinal tract, delayed peripheral glucose assimilation and gluconeogenesis, decreased hepatic glucose uptake, and decreased peripheral tissue glucose disposal. Diabetes has also been seen in some of the studies associated with hyperthyroidism. This increased level of thyroid hormone leads to reduced half-life of insulin, impaired pro-insulin processing, and increased glucose absorption from gastrointestinal tract. When seeing the HPA axis, that is hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis and diabetes, the dysregulation of HPA axis has been associated with diabetes. Hudson et al. And Cameron et al. Reported 43% and 55% of diabetic patients as cortisol non-suppressors on dexamethasone suppression test. Altered cortisol action occurs also in glucose intolerance. A number of cross-sectional cohort studies have found that higher plasma cortisol is associated with insulin resistance and hypertrichemia. Hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis and diabetes. Laura et al. Report significant inverse association of total testosterone with diabetes. National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey 3 results showed associations for free and bioavailable testosterone, but not for total testosterone with diabetes. Some animal models suggest that diabetes in the rat causes a reduction in lytic cell number and testosterone secretion. Others suggest that testosterone regulates insulin sensitivity and insulin gene expression. Pineal gland hormone in diabetes, that is melatonin in diabetes. Melatonin, neurohormone synthesized nocturnally in mammals, mainly in the pineal gland. Regulation of circadian is the main function. It also participates in energy balance control. The melatonin receptors, namely MTR1 and MTR2, are coupled with beta cells of islets of Langerhans through three parallel signaling pathways, visually cyclic AMP, cyclic GMP, and inositol triphosphate pathway, with different influences on insulin secretion. Keeping all these things in mind and seeing that the many studies, they suggest that diabetes or abnormal endocrine function are interconnected. seeing this thing and keeping these things in mind, the aim of the present study was to investigate endocrine function in males with prediabetes, as there were no studies regarding prediabetes and endocrine function. So this study was conducted to assess, to investigate endocrine function in males with prediabetes. To reach this aim, the objectives are, primary objective is to estimate HPT excess hormone, HPA excess and HPG excess hormone, and pineal gland hormone and insulin levels in normal, pre-diabetes and diabetes male subjects and compare them between the group. The secondary objective is to correlate all these hormones with fasting plasma glucose and insulin, all the three groups. Furthermore, the materials and methods to conduct this study are, 400 male subjects aged 25 to 45 years were screened with their consent. Out of these, 295 male subjects were excluded. Either they have the history of diabetes or they had other endocrine disorders, kidney disease or cardiac diseases. Either they were the known case of dyslipidemia, hypertension and diabetes on treatment, or individuals who were taking drugs altering glucose and lipid levels. Remaining 105 male subjects were grouped based on their FPG values as 35 pre-diabetes having FPG between 101 and 125, 35 healthy controls when FPG was less than or equal to 100, and 35 diabetes patients, diabetes subjects, where FPG is more than or equal to 126 milligram per deciliter. Their serum samples were collected and stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius until further analysis. Plasma FPG was tested using method glucose oxidase peroxidase in Roche-Cobas P800 automated analyzer, and all other analytes were analyzed using ELISA method in ELX800 by Biotech Instruments. Statistical analysis was conducted using SPSS version 20. Data was analyzed using ANOVA and Tukey's post-hoc test. Correlation analysis was done using Pearson's correlation and value less than 0.05 was considered significant. Coming to the results of this study, comparison of mean age, FPG and insulin between the groups, it was observed that age was comparable between the three groups, suggesting that there was no bias or the age criteria was being considered significantly in this study. FPG, they show significant difference among the three groups because FPG was the grouping criteria. Now, coming to the insulin, it was observed that insulin in pre-diabetes males was significantly higher as compared to insulin in healthy controls and was considerably lower, significantly lower as compared to diabetes. Here, the superscript A suggests p-value less than 0.05 when compared with healthy controls. Superscript B suggests p-value less than 0.05 when it is compared with pre-diabetes group. And C suggests p-value less than 0.05 when compared with diabetes group. It is same in all the results. Now, according to my first objective, it was estimation of all the hormones and then comparison them between the groups. So let's start with HPT excess hormone. When mean TRH and mean TSH groups and TSH levels were compared between the groups, it was observed that in pre-diabetes group, the mean value of TRH and TSH was significantly higher as compared to healthy controls, but significantly lower as compared to diabetes. When free T3 and free T4 were compared, it was observed that though the values were within the normal range, but in pre-diabetes group, value of free T3 and free T4 was significantly lower as compared to healthy controls, but was comparable as compared to diabetes group. There was no significant difference between pre-diabetes and diabetes group in terms of mean free T3 and mean free T4. Comparison of HPA excess hormone between the groups. When CRH was compared, it was observed that the mean CRH value in pre-diabetes group was significantly lower as compared to healthy controls and diabetes both. In case of ACTH, it was observed that again the value of mean ACTH in pre-diabetes group was significantly lower as compared to both healthy controls and diabetes group. In case of cortisol, the observation was a little different. It was observed that the mean cortisol value in pre-diabetes group is significantly lower as compared to diabetes group, but was comparable when compared with healthy controls. Comparison of HPG excess hormone between the groups, mean GnRH. When it was compared, it was observed that the mean GnRH value in pre-diabetes group is significantly lower as compared to diabetes group, but was comparable as compared to healthy controls.